So, good morning, everyone. So first, I'd like to say that I'm extremely grateful to the organizers for inviting me to this inspiring and well-organized conference. And so I'm very grateful to be able to present some work to you. So my topic is, applications of ADS-CFT to both elementary particle and condensed matter physics. And so this is a huge subject, so inevitably I had to make some choices. And I hope the choices are made will enable us to draw some more general conclusions from what I'm going to say. So obviously the starting point for the subject is the ADS-CFT correspondence as conjectured by Maldacena, which states that a SUN gauge theory, which is a quantum field theory, is dual to a strength theory, which is a quantum theory of gravity. And then in the so-called Maldacena limit, which is a very important decoupling limit, which I noted down here, this quantum field theory goes to a large N gauge theory, which is strongly coupled in the sense that the TUF coupling is large. And this quantum theory of gravity goes just to classical gravity with point-like particles and is weakly coupled. So in addition to the intrinsic interest in this proposal, there's some very useful information here because a strongly coupled quantum field theory, which is generally very difficult to treat by standard methods, is mapped to a classical gravity theory, which is very easy to describe. And so very early on, the idea arose to take this approach to actually learn more about these strongly coupled gauge theories. And so to be able to apply this idea to more general situations, the conjecture has been extended to more general gravity solutions, in particular the original ADSN times SM geometry was generalized to more involved geometries. And so in particular, we can also consider examples where we have dualities to non-conformal and also non-supersymmetric quantum field theories. So this general topic goes under the name of gauge gravity duality. So that in this sense, I'm going to use this expression. And it is fair to say that this is an important approach to studying strongly coupled systems. And it has provided new links of string theory to other areas of physics. And I'm going to show you some examples for this in this talk. So let me list a few areas of physics where this has proved very useful, one of which is QCD at low energies. And so there have been a lot of results of very great importance in relation to the quark-gluon plasma. And today I would like to show you some few further applications and comparisons both to lattice gauge theory and also to QCD under the influence of external magnetic fields. On the other hand, as far as condensed matter physics is concerned, we had a lot of input about quantum phase transitions, about conductivities and further transport processes. And also there's this very important topic of the holographic superconductors. And today I would like to show you some new examples, one of which is the Kondo model and the other one relates to the so-called vial semimetals, which I'm also going to introduce to you. So an important unifying concept in all this is the concept of universality. And I think I should define what I exactly mean by this. So this word comes from the theory of the renormalization group, where it means that the large-scale behavior is independent of the microscopic degrees of freedom. And so different theories can flow to the same renormalization group fixed point. But I think a lesson we have learned from the subject of applied ADS-CFT is that universality has a much broader meaning in the sense that the same physical phenomenon may occur in different branches of physics. So this is a kind of new enlarged definition of universality which seems to emerge, and I would like to show you some examples for this in my talk. A last general remark is that there's different approaches which we can use in this field which come under the name of top-down and bottom-up approach. Top-down approach means that one starts from some action in 10 or 11 dimensional gravity or supergravity. A further very interesting and useful top-down approach is the study of probe brains, where you embed a probe brain into a particular background geometry in 10 or 11 dimensions. And so this is a very useful approach for introducing fundamental degrees of freedom like electrons or quarks into your system. And so these top-down approaches are very useful. because they have very few parameters. And what is also very important, that there are many examples where the dual field theory Lagrangian is actually known, and so which you can use to actually make comparisons. So I would very much like to advocate this top-down approach. But of course, a lot of very important results have been obtained in the bottom-up approach, which means that you choose a simpler, mostly four- or five-dimensional gravity action. And this has a lot of flexibility, so also geometries with some rather non-trivial scaling behavior can be considered. And also, of course, this approach is much simpler, and for just finding universal behaviors, this may be very useful. However, in this case, of course, it's hard to determine precisely the Lagrangian of the dual field theory. And I should mention that this, in this bottom-up approach, there was a huge amount of very important results, both in QCD and condensed matter by these groups of people, and of course, many, many others. And of course, to achieve a lot of success, eventually both these approaches should be combined and compared. And I hope in my talk I show you some examples where we actually see such comparisons. Okay, so this brings me to the outline of my talk. I chose to show you four examples which elucidate the concepts I just showed you in my introduction. The first is I'm going to present you a new model for the Kondo effect in holography. Then I'm going to talk about the condensation to new ground states, especially to new ground states in external magnetic fields. I have some new results about mesons in QCD, in holographic QCD. And finally, I'm going to talk about some issues related to the axial anomaly, which also has applications in both QCD and condensed matter physics. Okay, and as I pointed out, there's a unifying theme to these four examples, which is this concept of universality in this broader sense which I introduced to you. Okay, so let me start with the Kondo model. First, I should tell you what the Kondo effect is, or I'll give you a very brief reminder of what this is. So in condensed matter physics, the Kondo effect means that there's a screening of a magnetic impurity by conduction electrons at low temperatures. And so let me explain why we would like to consider the system within gauge gravity duality. Well, so first of all, this original Kondo model is a very simple model for a renormalization group flow, which also involves a dynamical scale generation. And so I think there's intrinsic interest in studying this, and maybe we can learn more about holographic energy flows from this very simple system. And secondly, of course, this is a ubiquitous model in condensed matter physics, and so we can expect there will be new applications of gauge gravity duality to condensed matter physics in this context. Let me briefly show you this physical picture of what the Kondo effect is. So there's definitely an energy flow from a UV to an IR fixed point. At the UV, you have this impurity spin, which is this red spin, and in condensed matter physics, then you consider free electrons, which are denoted by the blue spins. At the UV fixed point, they don't interact with each other. But then when you flow to the IR, you have a strongly coupled situation where these blue electrons screen this impurity, and so they form a collective new bound state with the impurity, such that when you go far away, you can't see it anymore. And so note this RG flow idea behind this. Okay, let me very briefly tell you about the situation in field theory, because then it will be very easy to understand what we have to do on the gravity side to describe this. So this model goes back to Kondo in 1964, where he studied a magnetic impurity interacting with a free electron gas. And so the screening of the impurity at low temperatures has an experimental signal, which has been observed experimentally, that there's a logarithmic rise of the I think this should be the resistivity, sorry, there's a typo here, at low temperatures. And so there's a dynamical scale generation. And due to the symmetries which you have in the system, you have just one spin sitting at the origin in your three-dimensional volume, but then you can just introduce spherical coordinates. And so you effectively have a one plus one-dimensional model. And here you have the Hamiltonian for this one plus one dimension model. So here you have your electrons, which are in one plus one dimensions. These are given by chiral fermions due to the symmetries. And then you have this interaction at a point in space with the Kondo coupling. this is your impurity spin, and it couples to the current of the electrons which are around. So this is your interaction, which is localized at this point. Okay, so and this model has been very decisive in the development of the renormalization group theory. And also, of course, at the IR fixed point, it can be described by a conformal field theory, and actually Affleck and Ludwig pioneered a conformal field theory approach to the theory at the low energy fixed point, which has proved to be very useful to actually determine the whole spectrum at the IR fixed point. Okay, so now we plan to model the system in holography. And so obviously, since we are in the large N limit, we also have to have large N in this case here, which means that the spin group for these impurity spins should be SUN with N large. And this has actually been studied in condensed matter physics already some time ago. And it turned out that in this case, the interaction term simplifies by introducing so-called slave fermions. So this impurity spin is written as a bilinear into auxiliary fermions here. And then we chose a totally anti-symmetric representation for the spin operator. This means we consider a Young tableau with Q boxes. And there's a constraint because the charge density associated with these slave fermions is given by Q, which is related to the number of boxes in this way. And this important constraint will also show up in our dual gravity construction. And then in the large N limit, actually the interaction simplifies quite a lot because you can use Fiat's identities. And so if you evaluate this bilinear or this operator using the Fiat's identities, lots of trace terms drop out because they go with 1 over N. And so we end up with a bilinear in two scalar operators where O is this complex operator which involves one electron and one slave fermion. And so as was discovered already within condensed matter physics, actually in the screen phase, we have a condensate and this operator condenses to a new ground state. And of course, this phase transition in this low dimensional system can only happen because we are in the large N limit. If we have 1 over N corrections, then of course it will be washed out to a crossover. But so this already very much suggests what we do have to do on the gravity side because actually, it will turn out that our model will be an ADS holographic superconductor in ADS2 space, which has precisely this condensate. Let me note that there have already been quite a few studies of holographic models with impurities, where people studied the theory at the IR fixed point, and this describes supersymmetric defects with localized fermions. And so I recommend all of these papers to you. So the new thing about our model, which I obtained in collaboration with my collaborators Carlos Hoyos, Andy O'Bonnen, and Jackson Wu, is that we actually managed to describe the entire RG flow, which I just showed to you. So one important point is that there's a big difference to the standard quantum model, because in the standard quantum model, you have a free electron gas which interacts with one impurity, so there's only one coupling, this Kondo coupling. However, we're doing holography in the Malacena limit, and this means our gas of electrons, which is given by the NX24 theory in principle, is already strongly coupled, and the TUF coupling is large before we actually add the impurity. So now we have two couplings. We have the TUF coupling, and we have the Kondo coupling. And of course, the TUF coupling will always be large, and this means that we actually couple a magnetic impurity to a strongly interacting non-Fermi liquid. Let me briefly list the results which we get by this approach. So we obtain an RG flow from perturbing by a so-called double trace operator, where I put this into inverted commas because it's actually two operators which are gauge invariant because they are made up of a product of two fundamental fields, so there's no traces. But nevertheless, it's a product of two operators, so that's where we can use this double trace approach. We also see this dynamical scale generation, which is very important in the quantum model and which makes this model similar to QCD. So in QCD, there's also a scale generation at low energies. And so it turns out that the holographic model will involve an ADS2 holographic superconductor. We can't see this logarithmic behavior of the resistivity at low temperatures because that's an effect of the free electron gas. However, here we get some interesting power law scaling of the conductivity with a real exponent. And we can also see the screening, and there will be a phase shift in our model. So there's some interesting generalizations related to quantum quenches, and also this is a starting point also for studying the Kondo lattice. Okay, so let me show you our model, which is actually a top-down model, as I introduced in my introduction. So, and of course, as always, in the simplest example of the ADS-TFT correspondence, we start with n D3 brains in those directions, and n is going to be very large. And then we add a small number of D7 brains, which span here the 0 and 1 direction, and then those. So these give rise to the two-dimensional theory. And then the impurity will be generated by D5 brains, which sit here and then here in those internal directions. And then we can actually determine all the degrees of freedom by looking at the different strings which you can have between these sets of brains. So the 3-7 strings will give you the chiral fermions, psi, in 1 plus 1 dimensions. The 3-5 strings will give you the slave fermions, which I introduced to you, which are in 0 plus 1 dimensions. And then, very importantly, there will be a scalar associated with the strings between the D7 and the D5 brains. And so this actually breaks supersymmetry. So this will be a tachyon, and this is exactly what we need to see this condensation process, which I mentioned. And so now if we go to the gravity dual side and take the near horizon limit, the D3 will give rise to the original ADS 5 times its 5 geometry. And then we will have some subspaces. So the D7 gives an ADS 3 times its 5, in which there will be a Trans-Simons field. And this Trans-Simons field will be dual to this electron current. On the other hand, the D5 brains will wrap ADS 2 times its 4. And so these involve a Young-Mills field whose time component will precisely be dual to this charge density of the slave fermions, which is related to the representation of the spin impurity. And there will be the scalar dual to a product of an electron and a slave fermion, which is actually going to condense. So, and we can, in this way, establish this very precise operator field operator map. So the electron current is dual to a Trans-Simons gauge field denoted by a capital A, which lives in an ADS3 space. The charge, which is related to this charge density here, is dual to a two-dimensional Young-Mills gauge field denoted by a little a in two-dimensional anti-de-Sitter space. And then there's the scalar operator O, which involves an electron and a slave fermion, which is dual to a two-dimensional complex scalar on the gravity side. So that's the model which we would like to study. And now here comes the point where we have to go from this top-down to the bottom-up approach, because the model I just presented will be quite difficult to study, and also we are not so quite sure what the potential is. I mean, in principle, I think this can be worked out. And also, if we are in the probe limit, of course, these D5, D7 strings, they will be suppressed by an order of n, so they will be hard to see. So we decided at this point to change to a bottom-up model, which is simpler, and it has the following structure. So it involves a Trans-Simons action in ADS3 and a two-dimensional action in ADS2. This is the Trans-Simons term, and this ADS term has this two-dimensional gauge field, and it has the complex scalar. And we choose this potential just to be a mass sum at the Breiten-Nunner-Friedmann bound for simplicity. And here you can see the covariant derivative, which involves both the three-dimensional and the two-dimensional gauge field. So we use the probe limit at present, so and study a BTZ black hole as given by this metric. Okay, so now I'm going to. No. Thank you. I was told I have 53 minutes. Okay. All right. Okay, so and this gives us plenty of time to solve this model. And so let me tell you one further ingredient in solving this. So for this double trace deformation, we can use a method which was introduced by Witten already some time ago. And so this is the boundary expansion of our scalar field. And by imposing this linear relation between these two coefficients, then we actually find that kappa is dual to a double trace deformation. And this is precisely what we can use in this situation. By noting that this capital phi is invariant under renormalization, then we obtain a running coupling for this kappa. And in this situation where we have a temperature scale, what we get is this result here. And now we see this dynamical scale generation because this denominator become zero at some particular scale. And so then we have exactly what we want, and so which also makes this model comparable to QCD. So here I just plotted this coupling for you. And so here we see this divergence. So this is the temperature over the renormalization scale. This is the Kondo coupling. And precisely this divergence determines this Kondo temperature below which the system is strongly coupled, this coupling to the impurity is strong. And then here we see that the scalar condenses. So this temperature sets precisely the scale where our holographic superconductor kicks in. Okay, so the picture which is emerged is that we have a flow from a UV to an IR fixed point. Unlike the standard Kondo model, everything is, the electrons are strongly interacting here, and of course they're still strongly interacting there as well. And then we have the second coupling, where we have a deformation by this double trace operator, which is our Kondo operator, and then here in the IR we will see a non-trivial condensate. And so now let me show you some numerical results from solving the equations of motions, which gives precisely this scenario. So in this figure, you see the normalized condensate as a function of the temperature, and both plots show the same. They show this condensate as a function of the temperature, just in different ranges of the temperature. So here, near the phase transition, we see that we have a mean field transition, and then if we look at very low temperatures, then we see that this condensate approaches a constant, which is reassuring because this means we really have an IR fixed point. And then we can actually really see in our model that the impurity is screened. And this we can see by considering the electric flux at the horizon. So it turns out in this construction that the electric flux through the ADS space at the boundary gives precisely this Q, which is the charge of the slave fermions, which sets the representation of the spin. And if we calculate the same flux at the horizon, we see that it decreases with the temperature. So this means the electrons further out see less and less from this impurity spin, and there's less of the degrees of freedom visible. And so this is really a very nice picture of the screening. The only thing is it doesn't go all the way to zero. So A prime of T is actually this flux. And so here we see the whole temperature range, and then zooming in on very low temperatures, we see that it goes to a finite value, which means we have a form of so-called underscreening. However, it's different from underscreening in the normal Kondo effect because already our electron gas is strongly coupled. Okay, so now, of course, the interesting thing is, because I told you that in the original Kondo model, there was this logarithmic behavior of the resistivity. And in fact, so here we won't see this because we don't have a free electron gas. Nevertheless, from a simple scaling argument, we can determine what our resistivity does. So we have a stable IR fixed point, and this means that near this fixed point, the dynamics is determined by the so-called leading irrelevant operator, which is in this case the operator dual to the two-dimensional Young-Mills field. And by some variant of the Higgs mechanism, this field gives some additional mass to the complex scalar, which changes the dimension in such a way. And this then means, by a scaling argument, you can then determine the resistivity, and so also the entropy and density, and we get this behavior here. So note to evaluate this that this dimension will always be bigger than one, but it will be a real number, so not any integer or fraction. And so what we get is we get a power law for the resistivity which has a real number bigger than one here in the temperature dependence. So, and I have been told by condensed matter physicists that this is very interesting because this is actually the behavior expected also for a Luttinger liquid. And so this deserves clearly further study to understanding this better. And so there's a clear sign that this can be relevant for describing systems which are strongly coupled nature coupled to such an impurity. So that's very reassuring. And so this means we should in the future have a closer look at the transport properties, also at the thermodynamics, and another possibility when including the Buck reaction is to actually calculate the entanglement entropy. We can also introduce a time dependence in this model and consider a quench. And it's also the starting point for considering condor lattices. Okay, so that brings me to the end of my first example. Now let me move on to the second example. The second example concerns the condensation to new ground states. And so the starting point is to consider the holographic superconductors, which we have known for some time now. In the easiest form of these were the S-way superconductor, where a charged scalar condenses. Then there's also models which are referred to as P-wave superconductors, where actually a current dual gauge field condenses. There you have some form of triplet pairing, and most importantly, the condensate breaks rotational symmetry, which will have important consequences. And so by looking at this with a probe-ray model, we actually find that the field theory dual operator is similar to the Rho meson. It takes structure like this. But of course, there's also bosons around because originally the theory was supersymmetric, although supersymmetric is broken by the charges. So let's look at these P-wave superconductors for a little bit. So we start with Einstein-Young-Mills theory with an SU2 gauge group. So this is in a bottom-up approach now again, which has involved a Ricci scalar, cosmological constant, and then SU2 gauge fields, which you see here. Then we also introduce this coupling alpha, which is the ratio of the gravitational coupling and the gauge coupling, this one. I mean, so the gravity gauge coupling. And then we make a particular ansatz for the gauge field, so we have an SU2 symmetry here, so there's a T3 Pauli matrix and a T1 Pauli matrix, and so there's two radially dependent fields here. And so we choose an ansatz where this field involves a chemical potential, which can be interpreted as an isospin chemical potential because we have two flavors, like the U and D quarks. And so then the interesting point is that this chemical potential explicitly breaks the SU2 symmetry to a U1-3 symmetry. And then if we solve the equations of motion with this ansatz, we find that this function doesn't have any leading term, there's just the subleading term at the boundary. And this means that we have spontaneous symmetry breaking, and this condensate is actually proportional to a current component in such a way. Now, let me make a small detour and tell you why this is very interesting. Of course, everybody knows, the most striking example for universality in applications of gauge gravity duality concerns the shear viscosity over entropy density, as calculated by these authors. And so we have this universal result in ADS CFT with the famous ratio of 1 over 4 pi. And there's actually different ways of proving that this result is universal. So there's no influence. So as long as the leading term in your gravity action is a Ricci scalar, I should emphasize. So there is, I won't consider the higher curvature terms for the purpose of this talk. So then you can actually show that any other fields in your gravity action or going to non-commutative spaces or so on won't change this result. And this proof of universality relies on the isotropy of space-time, which means that the metric fluctuations will be helicity 2 states. So that's the key ingredient for proving this universality. So now let's go back to the P-wave superconductors. So as I told you, there's a current condensing, which means that a rotational symmetry is broken. And in this case, the shear viscosity actually becomes a tensor. And in fact, so here we have just one axis singled out by a current. And this means that the fluctuations are characterized by transformation properties under the unbroken SO2, which are the rotations around this axis. And then this means that the metric fluctuations can now be either helicity 2 or helicity 1. depending on whether they have one leg along this axis and perpendicular or both of them perpendicular to it. And so the result is, as you can see here, if I now plot these two helicity components, if I now put these two shear viscosity components as a function of the temperature, so the one is given by this green line, so the helicity 2-1 component doesn't change, it remains at 1 over 4 pi. But here's our phase transition to the superconducting phase. And this other one, which is helicity 1, evades this universality proof, and so it actually grows, and so the magnitude of this growth depends on this coupling alpha, which gives you the ratio between the gravitational and the gauge coupling. And so we see that the bound is preserved, but nevertheless, this component is now non-universal because it depends on the temperature. So this helicity 1 component is dependent on both T and on alpha, and so we see non-universal behavior at leading order in both lambda and N. Okay, so it's interesting to note that we preserve the viscosity point in this construction. And so as was pointed out in this paper, I think it may be related to the fact that the energy momentum tensor remains spatially isotropic. So TXX and TYY and TZ are still the same, although we have this rotational breaking. And this seems to be closely related to the fact that the bound is preserved. Because there's other models due to Repan and Steinmiller where there's actually a violation of the viscosity bounds for an anisotropic system, but there also the energy momentum tensor is actually anisotropic, so this is a big difference from the model we considered here. So these anisotropic fluids have a lot of interest, so I just noted two recent papers here. And so let me point out that the second paper also looks at the influence of magnetic fields, which brings me to my next step, because so far we looked at a condensate in the background of an isospin density, but from this we can very simply switch to a SE2 magnetic field. So recall that, as we just saw, the necessary isospin chemical potential is provided by a non-trivial time component of the gauge field in the three-direction in isospin space. So 3 refers to the isospin space, T refers to the time component. And now we can replace this background field, the time component, by a spatial component of this form. And then something very interesting happens, and we still see a condensation process. And in fact, if there's a magnetic field which is bigger than some critical value, then the new ground state is a triangular lattice. So here you see the x and y coordinates, and the colors code the strength of this new rho. It's a rho meson condensate. And so the mod of the rho meson condensate corresponds to these colors. Now, this is very interesting because similar structure has been investigated in QCD recently. So by using effective field theory and also lattice gauge theory methods. And also there it was found that a magnetic field leads to rho meson condensation and superconductivity in the QCD vacuum. And so let me show you one plot from Maxime Ternoudoub, so who did this calculation both in effective field theory and later also in lattice gauge theory. So he has the x and y directions in space, and then he can give the mod of the rho meson condensate in MeV, and he gets this plot. Now, we did a very similar calculation using gauge gravity duality, and by putting a magnetic field in a black hole supergravity background, we could also introduce confinement by using a cutoff or a wall, for instance. And this gives us a very similar plot. And so I think you should see that these plots look very similar. And so in our case, we have the rho meson condensate normalized to the value of the critical magnetic field. But this overall structure, especially this triangular lattice, appears in both approaches. And I think this is very interesting because this is a true calculation in QCD. This is a true gauge gravity calculation, and the structure seems to be universal. And we can actually show that the triangular lattice is the most stable one by calculating the free energy as a function of the ratio between the lattice sides. And then if we do this, then we see that the quadratic lattice sits here and the triangular lattice is there. This is dual to a hexagonal lattice, of course, so these should be at the same height. And we see that the triangular lattice is the most stable one. So I think this is intrinsically interesting because we can compare these gauge gravity calculations to the QCD result. And let me also stress that the lattice is generated dynamically. So it's not put in by hand, it really is a result of the calculation. It's the new ground state. Okay, so let me discuss this very briefly. So so we have a spontaneously generated lattice ground state in a magnetic field. I shall point out that similar situations where instabilities were already considered by these authors in the 80s, where they saw a gluon or a W boson instability in the gauge theory. And so this triggered also this new renewed interest in the context of holography and triggered some new field theory investigations, in particular the analysis of fermions in such a model due to Tong and collaborators. Then I showed you these QCD results. Okay, there people are actually able to put some numbers, but note that the critical magnetic field which you need to be actually able to see this lattice is the rho meson mass squared over the electric charge, and this gives a huge number, so I'm not really sure you can really see this anywhere, but it's interesting how this number arises. It's because you have to make the lowest Landau level to go negative. And here we had this holographic model with an SU2 magnetic field. I should also say that a similar model has also been constructed in the context of the Sakai-Sugimoto model. And there's a wealth of other spontaneously generated inhomogeneous ground state which have been investigated, which have an interpretation as being new supergravity solutions, but also have potentially applications also for condensed matter physics. And there's situations with magnetic field, but you can also consider finite momenta with a Trans-Simons term. And so there's various things which have been done in a very important results. Okay, so let me move on to my next example, which is about quarks in the ADS-CFT correspondence. And this, let me go back a few years, but there has been some renewed interest in this now because there's new results from lattice gauge theory which are related to this approach. So let's consider a probe brain model where we take these 7 brain probes embedded in a D3 brain background, and then the quarks are the low energy limit of open strings between the D3 and D7 brains. And then, as shown some while ago, the meson masses are obtained from fluctuations of the D7 brain as given by the DVI action. So this is my very simple cartoon of anti de Sitter space, and this is the S5, and the blue object is the D7 brain. This can fluctuate, and the energy eigenvalues will give you meson masses. And some time back, we actually took such a D7 brain and embedded it into a confining background, so a geometry dual to a confining theory. And this actually gives a spontaneous breaking of a U1 axial symmetry, the symmetry which is in these two directions here. And this can be viewed as a toy model for chiral symmetry breaking. And so there's a new ground state given by a quark condensate, and obviously the spontaneous symmetry breaking should be associated to Goldstone bosons. And actually, this approach can be used to compare to recent lattice gauge theory results, because we can calculate the mass of the rho meson as a function of the pi meson mass squared in the large n limit, of course. And so what's done on the gravity side is to calculate the pi meson mass from the fluctuations of the D7 brain embedding coordinate. There's one parameter that, well, one parameter is the confining scale of your background, and another parameter is the bar quark mass, which is determined from the embedding boundary condition for your D7 brain. And then the rho meson masses are obtained from the gauge field fluctuations for the D7 brains. And so what is very interesting, that recently a group of lattice gauge theorists embarked on a program of also calculating mesons in the large N limit, which is very, very complicated to do and on the lattice and takes a lot of computer time. And now let me show you this really nice recent comparison, which was provided to me by Biagio Lucini, lattice gauge theorist. So what you see here is, first of all, you have to compare the two models, you have to normalize the confinement scale. So that's why we start at 1 here. And so here we dial the pi meson, which essentially is obtained by choosing the bare quark mass from the D7 brain embedding. And here is the Rho meson mass, and everything is normalized in units of the Rho meson mass at zero pi meson mass. So that's why we have a one here. And our ADS-CFT result, which I showed to you, corresponds to this black line. And what lattice gauge theories do is they take n for different values, which get bigger and bigger, and then they extrapolate to the large n limit. And so this gray shaded area is there suggested, these are their calculations for the different n's, and this gray region gives the uncertainty of this extrapolation to large n. And so the one first thing we should note is that our ADS-CFT result, which is just obtained from solving a gravity equation of motion, which we did on one laptop in one afternoon once we believed the construction, fits with this very intricate and complicated lattice gauge theory calculation, which is a true quantum calculation. So the first thing is that you should really be impressed that it works so well. So if I give you 30 seconds for being really impressed. Okay, so then the next step, of course, is we should move on. And so, of course, the lattice gauge theorists, first they can give error bars on their numerical error. And also they have this 1 over n estimate, or this large n extrapolation error estimate. So this clearly suggests we should continue. So we should be very happy it works so well, but now we should try to at least give some estimates for our error, which of course means we have to do something about 1 over square root lambda and 1 over n corrections. Now, of course, I know this is extremely hard to do, but I think this is definitely the next step to have further comparison to understand this better. And so this is certainly our homework for the next couple of years. I hope we can do at least get some further insight into this. Nevertheless, let me stress again, I mean, it's really impressive that it matches so well. So this clearly indicates there's some universal behavior. And also what I very much like about is it makes you talk to lattice gauge theorists. So they seem to be taking us seriously, and I'm very pleased about this. Okay. So let me say a few words about how to make progress towards this understanding this better. I should say also, you see for the lattice results, here there seems to be a linear behavior, but then here they get some quadratic corrections. Eventually this curve will actually, of course, flatten out once we are outside the region of confinement. Actually, what happens, so the reason why we see also a condensation progress can be viewed in this very simple model, which I show you here. So when we expand the D7 DBI action to quadratic order, we get a structure like this. So where essentially X is the embedding coordinate. And so the fact that we don't use ADS, but this confining geometry means that we get a change in the mass of this field. Okay, note that this is not in canonical normalization yet. If I change to canonical normalization, then the leading term for the mass is obviously given by the usual ADS-CFT relation. But now this confining background gives this extra term. And once this pushes us beyond the Breiten-Nuller-Friedmann bound, then obviously we have an instability and we get chiral symmetry breaking. So that's the universal feature behind these models. And to understand this better, there's a recent phenomenological, also more of bottom-up type model by Evans and Tuominen, where they just consider this effective five-dimensional metric and look at fluctuations of this type. And they make contact by QCD, so not that this is somewhat ad hoc, but certainly that's what you expect, what should happen, by taking this mass to be related to the anomalous dimension of QCD, which to one loop order takes this form with this alpha strong decoupling of the QCD. Then inserting this here, what they actually get is this plot, which was sent to me by Nick Evans and Mark Scott recently. So that's the same as before, the Rho meson mass over the pi meson mass squared. The blue rectangles are, again, from this group Biagio Lucchini and collaborators, which I showed you before. And the red dots are now this model, this phenomenological holographic model with different values of n. And you see, taking different values of n doesn't change very much, but there definitely seems to be also a quadratic behavior at larger masses. And So this is very interesting, and I can just repeat that this definitely requires further study, and we should understand this better. And nevertheless, it's a very nice starting point to have this exchange with that scale theorists. Let me just very briefly point out there's, of course, other possibilities of comparison to lattice gauge theory. I think another model which can be used in this context is one by our chairman, which I outline here, and which also could be used to study what I just showed you. And there's also just in pure SUN-Young-Mills theory without flavor, there's some lattice studies by Panero on of quark gluon plasma thermodynamics, also in the large N limit. There's also a very nice comparison to the ADS-QCD model of Kiritsis and collaborators. So there's already other approaches to this question. Okay, finally, let me come to my last example, which is about axial anomalies. And so the starting point, as found as in these two papers, which I mentioned up there, is to consider an action of nx2 dx2 5 supergravity, which is obtained from compactifying 11-dimensional supergravity on some suitable Calabi-Yau manifold. And so including supersymmetry, we get an action of this type, which also involves this 5-dimensional Chern-Simons term. And so the important point is that this Chern-Simons term leads to an axial anomaly for the boundary field theory. And so the approach of fluid gravity actually led us to investigate the contribution to relativistic hydrodynamics, which comes from this charged fluid. And actually, it was found that this Chern-Simons term also gives a vortical contribution to the hydrodynamic expansion of the current in this charged fluid. And this is proportional to the angular momentum. So this omega takes this form, and in the fluid rest frame, it just looks like this. So this leads to something called the chiral vortex effect. And as pointed out by Son and Surafka in a very beautiful paper, it has some effect of a chiral separation, which means if you have a volume of rotating quark matter, as shown here, then this term implies that quarks of opposite helicity have to move in opposite directions. So the left-handed particles go along the angular momentum, and the right-handed one go in the other direction. And this is a very important and drastic effect. And so this might actually happen in a heavy ion collision, because due to the non-centrality of colliding these pancakes, an angular momentum occurs, and there's a chance that this might actually be realized. I'm not aware if anybody started to look at this experimentally, but certainly the so-called chiral magnetic effect, which is the closed current of this chiral vortex effect, where a magnetic background field generates a charge separation, the relation of which to the chiral vortex effect was pointed out, for instance, in those papers. So this is certainly under experimental investigation in current heavy ion experiments. I should say that the anomaly induces a topological charge, because to actually see this effect, we have to break parity, and this is done by this topological charge, and so this leads to an axial chemical potential, which is associated to the difference in the number of left and right-handed fermions. All right, so now after this, there was a lot of progress in this field, and in particular, there was some very nice work about looking at this for the gravitational axial anomaly. So a similar holographic analysis, or also in addition a field theory analysis of this axial anomaly was carried out by mostly Karl Landsteiner and his group. And what they found was that both the holographic and the field theoretical analysis revealed that this coefficient of this gravitational contribution to the axial anomaly actually scales with T squared. So this seems to be true both at weak end and strong coupling. So this is a very interesting observation. But what is even more interesting, it might actually be possible to actually see this effect in Conan's matter physics. And this is also due to Karl Landsteiner and colleagues, and let me show to you how this proposal goes. So using linear response, actually the angular momentum creates an axial current, and the coefficient which you obtain using the Kubo formula is related to this mixed correlator of the axial current and the energy momentum tensor. It's precisely this quantity which scales as t squared. And since this Kubo formula involves this mixed correlator, we see that conversely, we can also consider this as a so-called axial magnetic effect, where there is a current generated by an axial magnetic field. So an axial magnetic field is a field which couples with opposite signs to the left and right-handed fermions. And this same coefficient should appear in this Kubo formula. Okay, so these Kubo formulas are related, and the coefficients should be the same. And so as these authors, this is a, some group of QCD physicists and also Karl Landsteiner proposed, then this should lead to an axial magnetic effect, which is possibly also observable. And what they proposed to see this experimentally is to consider the so-called vial semi-metals, which I'm going to introduce to you in the last few minutes of my talk. So one further thing, I mean, before I was talking about exchanges with lattice gauge theorists, but here there's also a very nice collaboration of people from QCD, string theory, and condensed matter physics. So let me point out that the virtue of this field is to bring together physicists from very different backgrounds, and I think this is a particularly nice example for this. So what they consider are the so-called semi-metals. So these are particular kinds of metals where he can see an example for such a band structure where the valence and conduction bands meet at isolated points like this. And also the Fermi energy should be around somewhere where these meeting points are. So these points are called Dirac points because they have a linear dispersion relation as for a relativistic Dirac fermion. And in addition, there might also be so-called vial semi-metals rather than Dirac semi-metals, where in addition, there's a chirality associated to these points. So one is associated with the left and the other one with the right-handed fermions. Such vial semi-metals don't yet exist in nature, but recently there was an experimental observation of the Dirac semi-metals, which are a kind of three-dimensional version of graphene, if you want. And so he has some references from experimental condensed matter physics and the alloys which people consider. And there's some hope by doping these or considering so-called heterostructures that also a vial semi-metal might be constructed. And so the interesting point now is that the axial anomaly, the gravitational axial anomaly implies that you should see a macroscopic angular momentum if you have a slab of this vial semi-metal. And so let me just very briefly say, so you have a wave vector which separates these two points. This wave vector corresponds to an axial vector potential. This in turn induces a magnetic field at the edges of the slab, because outside you have an insulator, so you should see a recombination of these vial points to Dirac points. And via the Kubo relation, which I introduced, this generates an angular momentum for the fermions. And then by angular momentum conservation, this should also lead to a rotation of the slab. And this whole effect should depend on the temperature. So you should see the angular momentum changing if you change the temperature, so which is a very interesting experimental proposal. And I really think this is a very nice example of this collaboration of people from different fields. Okay, so let me wrap up in the last 2 minutes. I showed you four, I think, nice examples which demonstrate the virtue of this applied ADS-CFT approach. I showed you a new model of the holographic Conway effect, which has an RG flow. I showed you new inhomogeneous ground states in magnetic fields. I showed comparison to lattice gauge theory as far as mesons are concerned. I showed you interesting results concerning axial anomalies, which have a nice link between quark-gluon plasma physics and condensed matter physics. I should say this is a very lively field, and at this conference there's a lot more talks about other fields which I didn't manage to cover here. In particular, what I didn't manage is to consider time dependence and quantum quenches. I think this is a very important new approach, and you will also hear talks about this here. And I think this is also something which has some very interesting prospects for the future. And so just to very briefly wrap up in 10 seconds, gauge gravity duality has established itself as an approach for describing strongly coupled systems. It creates unexpected relations between different branches of physics, which I would call with an extended notion of this word universality. It's now possible to compare results with lattice gauge theory, effective field theory, condensed matter physics. Certainly, it's fair to say that gauge gravity duality has added a new dimension to string theory. And in the future, what I would like to suggest is to explore more the mutual influence between more fundamental and more applied aspects of gauge gravity duality. Certainly, there's lots of methods out there which we haven't used yet. And on the other hand, we have so many nice results which maybe also should influence how our understanding about gauge gravity duality and its foundations. And I hope we can have further progress in understanding gauge gravity duality itself. And certainly, the first step would be to look at 1 over n and 1 over lambda corrections. So I think there's lots of things to do. It's very interesting prospects, and I hope some of you will be joining us to looking at these questions, and thank you very much.
Are there questions for Johanna?
In your first example, you got the scalar field to condense by adding this double trace-like term. What does that correspond to physically in the Kondo problem?
Well, it corresponds to what you expect from the large N Kondo model. So as has been showed by condensed matter physicists, they actually showed that this condensation process also happens on the field theory side. So there's the operator consists of a product of a electron and a slave fermion. And also on the field theory side, this actually condenses, as has been shown by condensed matter analyses.
Okay.
You mentioned that the power law alteration in the resistivity was something that you could derive using a leading irrelevant operator. Could this be recovered from studying an explicit current-current correlator?
Yes, that's a very good point. So this is work in progress, and so I have the scaling argument now, but certainly that's on our list of things to do, and we have certainly started to look at this. To get a better understanding, we have to do the full machinery of linear response, look at the correlators of the 3D currents, all the three fields which we have, look at all the two-point functions, and study all the transport coefficients. And this is certainly something which is on our list of things to do. We were first a little confused because there's a Trans-Simon term which has just one derivative, so it's not really clear what an infolding and an outgoing wave is if you just have one derivative, but I'm sure this can be solved, and so this is on your list of things to do, and I'm grateful for this question, so I think a much better understanding will come from doing this full linear response analysis, which has been done in lots of other applications of condensed matter, and we're certainly looking at this.
Since there are no other questions, let's thank Johanna again.